plain language of 79 and 28. It's the first submission.
Okay.
The second submission in Syed Ali Malawadis, Syed Ali dealt with show cause notice issued by customs preventive and not DRI. And Malawad, it is
by customs preventive
and not by DRI. But we have, it is a fact that we did not place any notification indicating customs preventive to be notified as a proper officer. We did not produce it, and therefore the judgment says we don't have any material to show he's a proper officer. But in the case of DRI and DGAE, board has already issued circulars empowering them to issue show cause notices. Empowering them to issue
show cause notices.
And day four, my lord, even though that board circular is page 415 PDF, that dated 1999, I'll give the circular number itself for the for DRA, I'll give the circular. Page 415. 15 February 1999. But it, even though, my lord, there is no specific reference to 2 within bracket 34, that should not be cited. No, no, you have not said 234. But the power is exercised by board and the authority to issue show cause notice has been granted by the board.
So there is no reference to section 234.
In that circular.
In the circular.
But it in form and in spirit.
Spirit.
It meets the requirements of 234, section 4 and 5. Because it is the same board. The authority to issue is by board. An authority to identify, it has identified a particular set of officers as empowering them to issue show cause notices. So they become proper officers under 28. So that Syed Ali will have no application to show cause
notices. Show cause notices.
So I've said that, though there is no reference to section 234 in the circular, it meets the requirements of section 234 and section 45, because the authority to issue and identify a set of officers rests with the board.
We meet with that requirement, statutory requirement. So the statutory requirement is met with, and therefore, my lord, Syed Ali will not apply to us. Once we succeed on 17 vis-a-vis 28, the first point we have to succeed, of course. Once we succeed, not for somebody to issue notice, he should have the power of assessment and reassessment under 17. Once we succeed that threshold, then, my lord, Syed Ali won't apply for DRA notices.
Once?
My lord, once we succeed on the earlier point, saying that, my lord, there is no requirement under 28. That the proper officer should do assessment or reassessment under 17, which is one of the ratios.
Just one thing, once there is no requirement.
Under section 28.
That the proper officer.
Who is to issue show cause notice? Who is competent to issue show cause notices? Should also be capable of doing assessment and reassessment under 17.
Same point.
Once we succeed on that point, my lord, then Syed Ali becomes inapplicable for all show cause notices issued by DRI and DGAA. DGAA started from 1998. DRI started from February 1999.
Why show cause notice issued by?
DRI.
What's the date?
15-2-1999. Post to the circular dated
15-2-1999. And DGA?
Well, I'll give the date itself. It's in the circular itself.
Post.
DGA circular is Karati. Now, DGA circular dated 21-1998.
Yes.
And why we are emphasizing this is plot. Both these points. Well, canon deals only with 3 points. Point number one, assessment and reassessment under 17 is reiterated in canon.
Okay, let's break down to canon and then finally we look at canon.
Yes, yes. And because
I
have to show a set of notifications, how we have been scrupulously following the law. I will show canon and then show to that. Yes. Not only two information, your lordship may take it on record. Now the Mangli impacts decision is stayed by this court. And the court was not from the judgment we see is not benefited by knowing this fact. So Mangli impacts and what the entire aspect of 28, which is the fulcrum of this case, but the whole case hinges on Validation Act and the whole Finance Act 2011. There is not a single reference about it in canon. The whole 28, that is why Lord Justice Joseph.
Come again.
Not the, whatever we have now argued in Mangli, well, we dealt in some 20 paragraphs. Lord, prior to 8.4, five things Mangli has
there is no reference in canon to.
Not this point was not argued in canon at all. The Validation Act was not even argued. From what I see in the judgment, what was, I was not there, I agree.
But you say it was not argued, we'll say it has not been dealt with
at all.
It was argued in great detail, Madam.
So we'll go by the record. We don't know what was argued, not argued.
No, it was on record, will show.
But not dealt with in
canon. No. They are dealt with also in a different manner. I will explain.
Let him conclude. Now, Mr. Vigatraman, your contention is that the Validation Act.
Yes, not only validation, but it has a 5-step process.
No, but what is. You are now identifying the deficiencies of canon. So what are the deficiencies? Why don't you itemize it?
Whatever happened between April 2011, from 8-4-2011 to 16-9-2011, plus the circular 23rd September 2011.
Sound travels faster than
I understand.
In the physical capacity of the gesture, right? So we'll go slow.
I was reminded of the classroom and the student.
I'll use a pencil with an eraser at the end because you see my notes.
Yes, your lordship.
If you want, I'll hand them over to you, to just.
As we do in iPad, your lordship does it with rubber and immediately rewrites it.
I otherwise use my electronic, but this I'm still on the older mode of I think take it down.
I must remember, I was a lecturer in mathematics in my original thing. And when I proposition, I used to dictate. The student used to write. I remember when my lord friend was writing, my lord writing was so meticulously. I was very impressed with
that. So I find that, even though it takes a little more time in the court, when you start dictating a judgment, it's of great value because it brings conceptual clarity and then you have a reference point when you go back,
I'm only wondering when I'm going to do my lord going to write tag down, but yes. I'll make it life simple.
All right.
I will not go up and down. I'll go step by step.
All right.
So, my lord, five important aspects happened between 8-4-2011 and my lord 23-9-2011.
One second.
Yes.
Has he finished with the Mangli impacts now? Now with the canon now?
1 minute, sir. I'm dealing with important aspect 20. In relation to Mangli, taking it to canon.
Between 8-4-2011 and.
But,
five important.
No, but five important aspects. But five important aspects which Mangli captures.
Between
8-4-2011
and Mangli.
16 September.
No, 8-4-2011 is the first finance act. 1 minute. Allow me, please. It starts with 8-4-2011. Yeah. There are five important, first milestone is...
No, no. But you said between. Between means today.
Yes. Okay? And yeah. And 23-9-2011. Correct. 23-9-2011.
Okay. Now you can itemize.
Now, what are the five steps important? 8-4-2011 is...
On 8-4-11.
Section 28 was amended and recast as 28-1 to 28-10 along with explanation 2.
Okay.
Yes. Then, my lord, in April 2011, I'll give the date in a minute's time. But in
that,
April 2000,
that is B now. That is B.
April 2011, I'll give the exact date. My lord, a circular was issued by the board. Yeah. Yes, my lord. It is 15th April 2011, para 22 of Mangli. 15th April 2011, para 22 of Mangli. Board issued a circular directing them because of Syed, because we didn't make
directing,
directing authorities wherever permissible in terms of time limits to reissue show cause notices under 28. By the field officers instead of customs preventive, wherever it could be possible. So this is 15-4-2011, second.
To reissue show cause notices under section 28.
So that it is covered by time. Third is, my lord, the statement of reasons. Which is, my lord, 2nd August 2011. A statement of objects and reasons. Give the date in a minute's time. Yes. Second. Well, before that, 6-7. Sorry. 6-7. Lord. The third step is on 6-7-2011.
Yes.
See, third. No, on 6th July 2011, that's the third step.
Yes.
On 6-7-2011.
See, C was the statement of objects and reasons.
No, no, no. Before that one step.
Okay.
See, C is on 6-7-2011.
Prior to statement of reasons. Yeah.
Prior to.
You'll have to wrap
prior.
It out.
My lord is right. Prior.
On
6-7-2011. Lord, we issued notification 44/2011 Lord, in line with notification 44 of 2011.
In line with
Syed Ali notifying for customs preventive and DRI to be proper officers. To take care of the future, which even Mangli upholds it. Third step. Fourth step, my lord, is the SOR, Statement of Reasons, dated 2nd August 2011. Para 28 of Mangli.
2nd August 2011.
We introduce, my lord, a bill in the parliament bringing Lord 28 subclause 11, the Validation Act. The Validation Bill. The Validation Bill dated 2nd August 2011 contains a statement of reasons bringing out in detail what we want to do.
Accompanying the bill introduced in parliament containing?
Containing the object. Why this validation is sought to be passed. It is only with a view to empower these four set of officers. Namely, customs preventive, DRA.
We'll take a statement of objects and reasons related to 811, para 28, Mangli, accompanying the bill introduced in parliament containing the objects of the validation.
Only object validated to empower.
Empowered.
These four sets of officers, namely customs preventive, DRA, DGA, which is logical, four sets of officers, the authority to issue show cause notices. And the last, and this is followed by two more steps. It should be six steps. Next, fifth step is, bill becomes an act on 16-9-2011. So 2811, which is a validation act, retrospective validation.
Became an act on?
16-9-2011. But with retrospective effect.
Complete retrospective.
Yes, yes, from
Became an act on 16.9.11.
Yes.
But with retrospective effect.
And last, the sixth step plot, para 31 of Mangli. On 23rd September 2011, we withdraw our earlier instructions issued on 15th April 2011. Because we have made a retrospective amendment.
The earlier instructions?
Issued on 15-4-2011. But this whole
Because 15.4.11 point B you had said on 15.4.11, a circular was issued by the board directing authorities wherever permissible to reissue show cause notice under 20.
We withdrew it because we amended.
Now there was no question of reissuing show cause notice.
So this is what six phases have happened between 8.4 and 23 September.
Right.
No discussion. Canon has not dealt this.
So we'll say the above aspect.
The entire sequence is missing in canon. And what I don't want the counsel to even, he did not get an ex parte order. We were also there. I'm not trying, he has not said, it is not figuring in the judgment. That's what I'm trying to say. This is not forming part of the judgment in canon. And what?
No, I mean, I'm sure with both of you there, you would have been argued it as threadbare as you are arguing it here. It was not noticed by the court.
That is all. And what? And this is not a statement we are making. Two judicial orders have said so. Just I'll show that here itself. Your Lordship may note. One is by my Lord Honorable Justice Joseph's bench, as he then was, my Lord, in Godrej and Boyce, which my Lord, Senior Counsel Hashada Hidayatullah is going to argue. My Lord, his matter.
Hashada Hidayatullah joined or no?
He was not joined. He is quite active. He should have been joined.
Joining from Pune, I think he stays in Pune.
yes.
I know, I've appeared as his junior in all these central excise matters in those days. And, you know, we used to travel the length and breadth of Mumbai before the collectors of customs and central excise, Vikroli and all those, you know.
Oh, what a journey.
We get on in life, but you know, you always respect people who have shaped your both sides.
Outstanding counsel, outstanding counsel. The article, triple five.
You won't believe it. I was telling my brothers yesterday when one would go to brief Mr. Hidayatullah, they used to stay in a building in Mumbai, and Chief Justice Hidayatullah by then had retired as. His term had come to an end as Vice President of India. So he would be sitting in the drawing room outside Arshad's chamber. And he would regale us with stories about his career as a judge, as a lawyer first, then judge in the Nagpur High Court, then tell us about, you know, his term as a judge of the Supreme Court, cases they decided, like this one, you know, the work which he did as Vice President of India. He's such a learned man. Incredible learning Justice Hidayatullah had. And razor sharp memory in his 80s.
Parasaran sir retains same memory power even today, Mula. He's 97. He can dish out what happened in a court at a what time before which judge in 1959. And where is it reported? He can trace it.
When Mr. Parasan opened the Ayodhya matter, I whispered to Chief Justice Gogoi, sitting to Justice Gogoi's left. So I mentioned to Honorable Chief, I said, Chief, it would like please tell Mr. Parasan that he may sit and argue. He doesn't have to get up because he was going to take 3 days or so. So Mr. Parasan told Justice Gogoi, he said, Justice, I'm grateful for this indulgence. The day I have to sit and argue, I know it's time to hang up my boots in the court. I'll not sit before the court and argue. So 3 days, I mean, he must have in those days been 92, 93, right?
5 years, 92, 2019.
You for 3 days without sitting, without a sip of water.
And without shoes on his legs, most importantly, without shoes on his legs.
Mr. Farid Nariman, after he stopped coming to court, he would occasionally do some cases. And he would insist on standing up in his study. So he got that pedestal, lectern. And he would argue from there. I said, why don't you sit down? So he said, no, I have always argued this way. I feel uncomfortable. That I may not do my best if I am sitting down.
So when he was connecting online, he would have his lectern and then...
Standing with this kind of a lectern, with a long lectern, in this small study towards the outside of his house, littered with books, and he would stand up and argue. But we have, I don't know if the lordships are aware, we have some judges in some high courts. And I'm saying it because the Chief Justice had some back issues. You know, some judges stand up periodically and conduct cases while standing on a lectern.
Sister Pratibha was telling me the other day when I had my back issue before weeks back.
I meant,
And she said that I actually stand up. I get up because the doctors have advised you just to take a little break after half an hour.
You can't keep sitting on.
Justice Anita Suman does it in Madras High Court. She has to break for a
while. Some of the British judges share with us that, look, you don't have the luxury of having, you know, all your ushers handing over books and files to us. There's a reason why we always get up to pick up a book is that you actually, because when you get up as a judge to pick up a book, you at least exercise your leg, because one of the professional hazards on this side is lower back and neck, because you're constantly sitting from the moment you wake up early morning to the last thing that you do on your desk in the night.
We require a strong backbone of the court also.
Not the first order, why I'm showing that I'm not, this is not a submission made by me. This is recorded by this court, page 555, PDF 555, it is one order. Canon was delivered in 2021. This is on 11-2-2022, my lord, in Godrej and Boys. And please, my lord, see, a short order has been recorded by his lordships as he then was.
Hey! Just interrupt for a second. After my friend finishes, you know, I'm only in the review. I am not in Malinga and all that. You know, for that, these experts are here, they will do.
Okay.
So I will address the lordships in review the moment he finishes, probably post-lunch.
Okay. I think you, yesterday he had promised he has to keep to his word. 12 o'clock, he said, yes. Lord, 1 hour, he said.
But
we came at
8:40,
so we've only gone 1 hour.
I'm going to start my 1 hour. This is only recollecting, Lord.
Start your 1 hour now.
No, Lord. I'll complete it. Your lordship, you know, I will never repeat it. I'll keep my time.
Whenever my friend finishes, I will take 45 minutes only of the reading.
And then the others will finish.
Only
as long as it's not malign.
Mr. Rohaji is named Mangali as Malinga.
But his throw will be as powerful as Malinga is. Without a doubt. But please see 555.
Yes.
In this special leave petition, may I read that?
Yes.
In this special leave petition, the High Court in the impugned order has purported to follow the judgment of this court reported in Canon India Private Limited. This is a judgment rendered by a bench of three learned judges. By the said judgment, this court has held that Additional Director General, Director of Revenue Intelligence cannot be treated as proper officer within the meaning of Section 234 of the Customs Act, read with Section 28 of the said Act. The contention, however, which is raised by the learned Attorney General and the learned ASG is that Additional Director General DRI is an officer of customs. Section 6 of the Customs Act, which has been found to be a repository of power to appoint a person to exercise the power under 28, according to the petitioner, is not relevant insofar as Additional Director General of DRI is concerned, for the reason that he is actually an officer of customs. What is more, according to the special petition, is it is stated he has been authorized by the board within the meaning of 234. More importantly, however, when questioned in this regard, it is pointed out Section 28(11) would come to the rescue of the petitioners for the reason additional director general will be treated as proper officer under the said provision, irrespective of the requirement declared under 234 of the Act. It is further pointed out, 2811 could not be brought to the notice of the bench which decided canon India. In such circumstances, we are included to issue notice in this matter. This was judicial order. This was shown before the bench which heard the Malad review of canon in open court.
Okay.
Yes. So, and what I will read Saravanan if required later. So these are two judicial orders which record the fact what has been missed out in canon. So I'm not making a statement on my own. So Malad 2811. Now we'll go to canon straight away, Malad.
Which is the second order?
Second, Malad, is the judgment of the Madras High Court, which we have kept it, Malad, in NC Alexander. I'll just refer only the paragraph numbers. It starts at Malad 685 PDF.
9-6-2022.
That's exactly something basic. Malad, the learned judge respectfully refers to canon and follows it also and says, I'm unable to follow now because of the amendment, but he brings out what has not been shown.
Let's just see that.
Yes, paragraph 221. It starts from para 221.
At page?
At the PDF page 801.
So what was the subject matter of challenge before the
Madras? Post the 2022 amendment, it challenged it. But this was the show cause.
Validity.
No, they did not know. The court did not examine validity. It had a pending show cause notices covered by canon. But the court had the benefit of 2022 amendment. So it says, I will read that paragraph first so that to say the learned judge has not tried to disobey or overreach canon. He has not done it. He has very carefully put it in paragraph 283 and 284. That's very important at 835. I will show that first. He has followed this judgment. But only says what has not been brought. 230, 83 and 84 may kindly be read first. 283, 84. That is at Malad PDF page 835. About 50 paragraphs, I don't want to read all 50. I'll just show 2-3, just as an example. 283 says, the above discussions and observations have been made only with a view to point out certain aspects which appears to have not been brought to the knowledge of the Honorable Supreme Court. Though the law laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court in canon India is a declaration of law under Article 141 of the Constitution and therefore binding on this court.
Saravanan very fairly says that he is bound by a Supreme Court judgment, but he has pointed out things which were not shown.
That is all. So I just wanted to, because there should not be any assumption.
Now let's go to canon, I think.
We'll go to canon. No difficulty. We'll go to canon.
We'll finish now canon in 5 minutes and we'll wrap up.
Oh, my Lord, I have 5 case laws to show. Supporting the legal, please. Just give me that time.
Supporting the? Supporting the?
Legal issues arising out of. Only 5 judgments, 2 constitutional bench judgments, 3.
Now let's quickly go to canon.
Can we'll go to canon, Malad, that's all. Please come to canon, PDF page 537. Malad, I'm only trying to say because I'm going to see one Malinga, Malad, arguing for the review. So let it be very clear. A review in this case is absolutely maintainable. Because many issues, not me, judicial orders say has not been brought to the notice of canon. That's a good ground for review. It's an error apparently.
And our own court says that.
What is that?
We don't have to go as far as the Madras High Court.
Because the court is concerned. So, Malad, please come to 537. PDF. It's a fairly short judgment, Malad, sir. Take only 10 minutes to read.
request, Milad. Milad, the whole case had about the exemption to the cameras. He wanted to bring the camera here, but the security is not allowing inside. So if Milad may permit us to bring it.
The Canon camera?
Yes. But the issue is not
a camera, Milad. The issue is on a poverty issue.
No, they are not allowing to come in.
But what are we going to do about the camera?
Yeah.
It's a question of law, right?
Yeah. It's a question of law on DRA notice.
That is the reason why I'm asking.
What is that you want us to see in the Canon camera? We have seen Canon cameras. Don't worry about
it. No, but I want to see the impugned camera before, my lord. That is the reason for it. Try to permit us to bring it.
Actually, the
language is
quite problem.
Hey, Balaji, the mails and emails
are
emails and copies are.
There is a good reason why I'm asking.
Hey, I'll have to respond in case, because we had some email exchange. In case he raises that, I'll place my response also in this court on that.
I will not raise that issue.
No. If it's going to be there, I'll bring the copies with me. I didn't bring it today, but I'll bring it in the afternoon. But please see, Canon, my lord, it starts at page 537. And my lord, please come to paragraph 9.
Five four.
It starts from 9. It's a short judgment. But the question that arises is whether DRA had authority in law to issue show cause notice under 28.4. 28.4 is extended period for recovery of duties allegedly not levied or paid when the goods have been cleared for import by Deputy Commissioner of Customs, who decided that the goods are exempted. It is necessary that the answer must flow from the power conferred by the statute. That is under section 28.4 of the Act. This section empowers the recovery of duties not paid, part paid, or erroneously refunded by reason of collusion or any willful misstatement or suppression of fact, and confers the power of recovery on the proper officer. The obvious intention is to recover the power to recover such duties not on any proper officer, but only the proper officer. Lot 28 uses the expression the proper officer, no doubt about it. So this court deals first that point. This court in Consolidated Coffee Board had held, secondly and more importantly, the user of the definitive article, the, before the word agreement, is in our view very significant. Parliament has not said an agreement or any agreement, for in relation to such export and in the context, the expression the agreement would refer to that agreement which is implicit in the sale occasioning the export. In Ishar Alloy Steel versus Jaiswal, the word the is the word used before nouns with a specifying or particularizing effect as opposed to the indefinite or generalizing force of a or an. It determines what particular thing is meant, that is, what particular thing we are to assume to be meant. The is always mentioned to denote a particular thing or a person. There are only two articles, a or an and the. A or an is known as the indefinite article because it does not specifically refer to a particular person or thing. On the other hand, the is called the definitive article because it points out and refers to a particular person or thing. There is no doubt if Parliament intended that any proper officer could have exercised power under Section 28.4, it could have used the word any. Parliament has employed the article the, not accidentally, but with an intention to designate a proper officer who had assessed the goods at the time of clearance. It must be clarified that the proper officer need not be the very officer who cleared the goods, but maybe his successor in office or any other office authorized to exercise the power within the same office. In this case, anyone authorized from the appraisal group, assessment is a term which includes determination of dutiability of the goods and the amount of duty payable with reference to inter alia, exemption or consumption of customs duty by so-and-so. The nature of the power to recover the duty, not paid or short paid after the goods have been assessed and cleared for import, is broadly a power of review, the earlier decision of assessment. Such a power is not inherent in any authority. Indeed, it has been conferred by Section 28 and other related provision. The power has been so conferred specifically on the proper officer, which must necessarily mean the proper officer who in the first instance assessed and cleared the goods, that is the Deputy Commissioner of Appraisal Group. Indeed, this must be so because no fiscal statute has been shown to us where power to reopen assessment or recover duties which have escaped assessment have been conferred on an officer other than an officer of the rank of or a rank of an officer who initially took the decision to assess the goods. When the statute confers the same power to perform an act on different officers, as in this case, the two officers, especially when they belong to different departments, well, that's the first error. Please mark this. Not the first error, I'll point out, let me read the finding and point out the error. Yes, different departments cannot exercise their powers in the same case. When one officer has exercised his power of assessment, the power to order reassessment must also be exercised by the same officer or his successor and not by another officer of another department, though he is designated to be an officer of the same rank. In our view, this would result in anarchical and unruly operation of statute, which is not contemplated by any canon of construction of this statute. It is well known that when a statute directs that the things be done in a certain way, it must be done in that way alone. As in this case, when the statute directs that the proper officer can determine, it does not mean any proper officer, but that proper officer alone. We find it completely impermissible to allow an officer who has not passed the original order of assessment to reopen the assessment on the ground that the duty was not paid, not levied by the original officer who had decided to clear the goods and who was competent and authorized to make assessment. The nature of power conferred under 28(4) to recover duties which have escaped assessment is in the nature of an administrative review, next error, of an act. The section must therefore be construed as conferring the power of such review on the same officer or his successor or any other officer who has been assigned the functions of an assessment. In other words, an officer who did the assessment could only undertake reassessment, which is involved in section 28(4). It is obvious that the reassessment and recovery of duties contemplated by section 28(4) is by the same authority and not by any superior authority such as appellate or revisional authority. It is therefore clear to us that additional Director General of DRA was not the proper officer to exercise powers under section 28(4), and the initiation of recovery proceedings in the present case is without any jurisdiction and liable to be set aside. At this stage, we must also examine whether additional Director General of DRI, who has issued the recovery notice under 28(4), was even a proper officer. The additional Director General can be considered to be a proper officer only if it is shown that he was a customs officer under the Customs Act. In addition, that he was entrusted with the function of a proper officer under Section 6 of the Customs Act. The additional Director General of DRI can be considered to be a custom officer only if he is shown to have been appointed as a custom officer under the Customs Act. So-and-so learned additional Solicitor General relied on notification dated so-and-so to show that all additional Director General of DRA have been appointed as Commissioner of Customs. At the relevant time, the central government was the appropriate authority to issue such a notification. This notification shows that all additional Director General mentioned in column 2 are appointed as Commissioner of Customs. The next step is to see whether additional Director General of DRA, who has been appointed as an officer of customs under the notification, has been entrusted with the function under 28 as a proper officer under the Customs Act. In support of the contention that he has been so entrusted with the function of a proper officer under 28, the Customs Act, ASG relied on notification 40/2012 issued by the Central Board of Excise and Customs. The notification confers various functions referred to in column 3 of the notification under the Customs Act on officers referred to in column 3. The relevant part of the notification is as follows. Then para 20. Because if you see the notification, serial number 3, it says refers to section 28, Deputy Commissioner, Assistant Commissioner. It appears that the Deputy Commissioner or Assistant Commissioner of Customs has been entrusted with the function under 28 by serial number 3 above. By reason of the fact that the functions are assigned to officers referred to in column 3, and those officers above the rank of officers mentioned in column 2, the Commissioner of Customs would be included as an officer entitled to perform the function under 28 of the Act, conferred on a Deputy Commissioner or Assistant Commissioner, but the notification appears to be ill-founded. The notification is purported to have been issued in exercise of the powers under subsection 34(2) of the Customs Act. This section does not confer any power on any authority to entrust any function to officers. The subsection is a part of the definition clause of the Act. It merely defines a proper officer. It reads as follows. Then, para 22. Section 6 is the only section which provides for entrustment of functions of customs officers on other officers of central or state government or local authority. It reads as follows. Para 23. If it was intended that officers of Directorate of Revenue Intelligence who are officers of central government should be entrusted with the functions of customs officers, it was imperative that the central government should have done so in exercise of its powers under Section 6 of the Act. The reason why such a power is conferred on the central government is obvious, and it is because the central government is the authority which appoints both the officers of DRA, which is set up under the notification 412-1957 issued by the Ministry of Finance, and the customs officers who till 11-5-2002 were appointed by the central government. The notification which purports to entrust function as proper officer under the Custom Act has been issued under the Central Board of Excise Customs in an exercise of a non-existing power under 234 of the Customs Act. The notification is obviously invalid, having been issued by an authority which had no power to do so in purported exercise of the power under a section which does not confer any such power. In the above context, it would be useful to refer to the decision of this court in Commissioner of Customs versus Syed Ali, wherein the proper officer in respect of jurisdictional area was concerned. The consideration made is as under. It was submitted that in the instant case, the import manifest and the bill of entry were filed before the additional collector of customs import Mumbai. The bill of entry was duly assessed and the benefit of the exemptions were extended subject to the execution of the bond by the importer, which was duly executed, undertaking the obligation of export. The learned counsel argued that the function of the preventive staff is confined to goods which are not manifested, and in respect of manifested goods, where the bill of entries are to be filed. I'll read next. Then, well, what can I go to? Therefore, I'll go to 25. We therefore hold that the entire proceeding in the present case initiated by the Additional Director General of DRA by issuing show cause notices in all the matters before us are invalid, without any authority of law, and liable to be set aside, and ensuing demands are also set aside. But we now capture one by one, Mulat, what are the errors in the judgment. Mulat, the first in our whole judgment, Mulat, proceeds on the footing.
The review is of this judgment.
Yes.
Can judgment?
Yes. First point, Mulat, the judgment proceeds on the assumption.
Little slowly.
Yes. That DRA officers are not officers of customs, they are officers of central government of a different department. I'm going to show that expression again. It says different department. And consequently, DRA should be entrusted by the central government as officers of customs
under Section 6,
without which any notification empowering them as proper officer under Section 234 is invalid. It's the first in our very respectful submission. What is the error apparent seeking a review? The error apparent is, my lord, the entire scheme of the Customs Act, from what I'm all I'm reading from the judgment, not when I say something is not there, I don't want anybody to be taken the offense. I'm making a repeated request. From this judgment, we don't see any reference, discussion, or finding on Section 3, Section 4, Section 5, Section 234, vis-a-vis Section 6. The first submission, why it requires to be reviewed. There is nothing in this judgment which suggests.
Sections
3, 4, 5, read with 234.
And?
Vis-a-vis Section 6.
Read with 234, yeah.
2 within bracket 34, proper officer.
Yes.
3 deals with class of officers.
That we have not.
Yes. 4. So, my lord, I don't know how to repeat because I've shown the notification, everything. Therefore, my lord, it is fundamental that a DRI officer is a class of officer under Section 3. He may be a commissioner of customs today in Mumbai port. He will be a commissioner of customs preventive tomorrow in the Calcutta port. He will be a commissioner of customs DRI in Delhi the day after.
Venkatraman, this you have argued. You may just continue the shortcomings.
Yes, yeah.
Complete them.
Yes, yes. I'll complete the sequence and then elaborate it. Now, so the first submission is 3, 4, 5, read with 234 vis-a-vis 6 as now. So, Lord, the follow-up submission is.
That's your second submission.
There is no need to entrust DRI a power by the central government. Because that will apply only to such of those officers belonging to central, state or local authority who are outside the ambit of 3, 4, 5. Section 6 would trigger only to such officers of the central government, state government and local authority who otherwise do not fall under 3, 4 or 5. And we have supported it by showing notifications. Tibetan police, border security force, administrators, development commissioners, police, income tax investigators. We will also, my lord, in fairness say, for any reason, my lord, we have shown two sets of notifications, both under 4, 4 and 5, classifying DRI officers, we have shown yesterday. And one notification classifying DRI officers also under Section 6.
Notifications of the central government.
Or state government, well, central government, yes.
Classified DRI officers.
Well, DRI officers, well, we have shown notifications under 3, under 4 and 5. And one notification under Section 6 also. But that cannot form the basis to say one of your notifications is under 6, so you should have entrusted. But at that point of time, prior to 11/5/2002, whether it is an exercise under 4 or exercise under 6, it was central government. So it materially doesn't matter. It is only a misquoting of the section because DRI officers have always been officers or class of officers of the customs. So any reference to any notification prior to 11/5/2002 indicating DRI officers to have been appointed under Section 6. Will be of no avail for two reasons. A, we have placed on record abundant notifications where DRI officers are notified under Section 4 and 5.
One second.
I'm sorry.
And two.
Two. We have also placed on record notifications issued under 6. In relation to various officers not belonging to the Ministry of Finance, but elsewhere. It can be central government, state government, or local authority entrusted with the functions. And three, we have placed on record the entire history of DRI. And how from 1957 to 1977, it traveled between MOF, Home Ministry. Yes, and from 19, well, I'm just putting it only under the respective buckets only. And from 1977 onwards, DRI has remained only part of Ministry of Finance. And therefore, they become class of officers under 3. No change post-77. They remain only as class of officers under Section 3. And fourth, just as a mark, Delhi High Court judgment of May 1971, recording this history and validating that DRI is nothing but part of Ministry of Finance. And lastly, any reference, well, not any notification by central government appointing DRI officers by referring to Section 6 is inconsequential. Since till
11-5-2002. Yes, till
11-5-2002, both under four, Section 4 and under Section 6. The appointing authority remained only central government. And therefore, at the highest, it can only be not a wrong quoting of the rule, wrong quoting of the section, or misquoted section, misreference, and not malod a legal invalidity. So, Malod, this is the crux of the first step, because this is a foundation. Once we get over that, there is no need for an entrustment under 6, then we go to the next stage. Not the court finds. Specifically, we shall tell the again department. It says that finding is very important. Not, it's an error apparent on the face of the court, in our very respectful opinion, because it says the DRI officers belong or officers of a different department. That is why this confusion in 20, whether they should do assessment, reassessment, all this will get now, my lord, reduced to my lord simple things. Para 14. Please come to para 14. Para 14, PDF page 546. That's our second contention.
Third contention.
Yes, second. So different.
Second,
it hurts.
Third.
First is, canon judgment proceeds on the assumption that DRI officers are not officers of the customs, but officers of central government of a different department.
Yes.
And consequently, DRI should be entrusted by the central government as officers of customs under Section 6, without which any notification empowering them as proper officers under 234 is invalid.
On which
then you gave us two reasons of the error apparent. Second was broken down in A to E.
A to E. And now third.
You submitted, there is no discussion on 3, 4, 5.
Correct.
34 vis-a-vis.
That's the first point.
Correct.
That's the second point. Now come to the
third point. I'm sorry, my lord. I stand corrected.
Yes.
I stand corrected. Third point is, my lord, there is a specific finding in paragraph 14 of the judgment.
You are referring to 14.
Of canon.
That DRI officers are after a different
department. That finding of fact is an error apparent. It can be treated as a subsidiary to point 2 itself, but have it as point 3. But at PDF page 546, where the statute confers the same power to perform an act on different officers, as in this case, the two officers, especially when they belong to different departments, that is the whole confusion. That is why it says this officer can do assessment, that officer cannot do assessment. He has to do it 17, he has to do it at 20. All this is because they felt DRI is a stranger to the Minister of Finance and stranger to the whole scheme. So this finding, my lord, in the teeth of 3, 4 and 5 is an error apparent on the face of record.
Right.
Second, third point. Then, my lord, the fourth point in our very respectful view will be para 15.
What's the fourth point?
Fourth point, Lord. Para 15 says it deals with the nature of power under 28.4. And, Lord, this is what it precisely says. I'll read the sentence itself. Please come to para 15. Last four lines of PDF page 546.
Nature of power under section?
Lord, it says the nature of power conferred under 28.4. To recover duties and escape assessment is the nature of an administrative review of an act. Lord, with deep respect, it is not an administrative review. It's a quasi-judicial discretion. And therefore, the statute can appoint anybody. That is, Lord, the third error apparent on the face of record. It proceeds on the footing that 28.4 is an administrative review. And the last, my lord, is para 13. Para 13. 13, my lord, 13. Quote para 13 and 14 for this reason. But it says, para 13, my lord, one last time I may be permitted to read, because this is very crucial, my lord.
Yeah.
The nature of power to recover the duty, not paid or short paid, after the goods have been assessed and cleared for the port, is broadly a power to review the earlier decision of assessment. Such a power is not inherent in any authority. Therefore, indeed, it has been conferred by Section 28 and other related provisions. We agree. The power has been so conferred specifically on the proper officer, which must necessarily mean the proper officer who, in the first instance, assessed and cleared the goods, the Deputy Commissioner Appraisal Group, indeed dispersed be so because, but this is an error. No fiscal statute has been shown to us where the power to reopen assessment or recover duties which has escaped assessment has been conferred on an officer other than an officer of the rank of an officer who initially took the decision to assess the goods. Followed by para 14, by doing this, what happens, my lord? This is what the court says. Where the statute confers the same power to perform an act of different officers, as in the case, the two officers, especially when they belong to different departments, cannot exercise their power in the same case. When one officer has exercised his power of assessment, the power to order reassessment will also be exercised by the same officer or his successors and not by another officer of another department, though is designated to be an officer of the same rank. In our view, this would result in anarchical and unruly operation of the statute, which is not contemplated by any canon of construction of statute. But the error is, Now, two errors. The misconception that they belong to a different department and therefore power has been now given to two different departments to assess the same import is an error apparent.
So how do you formulate it?
Yes. Lord, reading para 13 and 14.
Little slowly.
I'm sorry. Lord, in terms of para 13 and 14, the court proceeds on the assumption. Or the court concludes, by assumption, the court concludes that two sets of departments are involved. One is the customs department, another is non-customs. Two departments are involved. In the process of issuing a notice and adjudication under 28. And concludes further.
Are involved in the process?
Of issuing, involved in the process of section 28.
Of issuing a notice and adjudication.
In terms of section 28. In terms of, and concludes further, no statute has been shown, no fiscal statute has been shown empowering two different departments to do assessment and reassessment. That is the error apparent on the face of it. There are no two departments here. Not today's DRA officer will be tomorrow field customs. Today's field custom officer will be tomorrow's preventive. Tomorrow's preventive will be day after tomorrow GST officer. All same rank. So there are no, but there are two errors in great respect, 13 and 14. First, to assume two departments. And therefore to assume, because you are involving two departments, we have not heard in any, seen any fiscal statute in India where two departments are involved in assessment and pre-assessment.
Yes.
And the last one, my lord, is para 9 to 12, the proper officer. How to construe the expression the proper officer? And my lord, reliance is placed on the coffee boat's case. My lord, Shanmuga Vilas Cashew, coffee boat, my lord, some from 64 to 75, my lord, constitutional bench judgments on this section 5. I'll take one by one and deal with it. So the proper, so according to them, because you are involving two, one more error, because you're involving two departments, the proper officer should be to the customs department and he should have originally assessed it. You can't bring a police officer. We are not bringing a police officer. We are not asking some border security force to do this. So the presumption, the proper officer, according to the judgment, but we have to see the whole. We can't read the proper officer only in para 9 to 12. The proper officer, my lord, has an influence across the judgment. According to the court, the proper officer, if I satisfy your lordships, the DRA officer is also an officer of customs, then he will be the proper officer once notified under 234. What is the problem?
So we have said this, the sixth error is that paras 9 to 12 construe the expression the proper officer to mean that the officer must be a customs officer who has originally made the assessment.
And it and assumes that DRA officers are not customs officers because that is inherent, 13, 14, 15. And therefore can never qualify as the proper officer even though notified under 234. It says that. DRA officer can never qualify as the proper officer, even though notified under 234, because he is not interested under section 6. It goes back to the old story. Same.
Yeah.
Same story. Same. These are the six apparent errors. Which your lordships, my lord, in our respectful opinion, my lord, a handful of three cases or three or four cases cannot decide the fate of thousands of cases. especially when hundreds of them were pending simultaneously on this very issue. And Mangali impacts has been stayed and Sunil Gupta has been dismissed on delay. This is the this is where it stands. But let me deal with them. Should I deal with each one of them separately? But I leave it there.
What do you want to say?
Six points I've dealt with. Well, these are there. Let him. Now I have only two things to. I'll complete it in next 15 minutes, Mulot. Definitely before lunch. I have two sets of things to show. Once, Mulot, because it is repeatedly coming again and again, Mulot, even in para 14 for the third time, that in view of this, it will result in anarchical and unruly operation of a statute which is not contemplated by canon of construction. And Mulot, Mangal impacts in para 70 says, if a designated authority is asked to answer the show cause notice, it's valid. We want to show from 1999 till date how meticulous we have been in set by a set of notifications issued, including in this batch of canon. That's on record, Mulot, we show the notifications on facts and three judgments and I'll rest my case. These are the two things. Well, the notifications are all, Mulot, starting from page. Yes. Will your lordship be kind enough to come to Mulot, page 899 PDF, correct?
They were issued from which year?
Saizali came in 2011. We issued on 6-7-2011, 44-2011. Mulot, empowering them for future. But Mulot, what is relevant and important is
okay.
Yes, Mulot. Before the notification, may I show this also, Mulot? One. The endings. Not dreaming, just 1 minute. Only 1 minute, sorry. Yes. Yes, notification is there. I'll show that. But please see the first
899. That's about June 2015.
60 of 2015. But this is issued by the central government. I will also show one more, not prior to 2015 in a minute's time. I kept it.
This is page 899. 899. Why don't you give us in chronological order, whatever you want to
get. Yes, Mulot. Can you give only 1 minute? I searched that.
Yeah, sure. 19.
Just 1 minute, Mulot. I want to show it from 1999 itself.